Tonight, go fly a kite with a local master of the sport and see just how far things have come in the mere 3,000 years since humankind first took to the skies. We'll learn how to build a custom kite, then take you to a fly-in for a look at all manner of string-tethered flying devices. And we'll take our annual parting look at the visual wonder of the Northern Autumn, bid farewell to fall, and welcome in the you-know-what.
Welcome to Crossroads. I'm Enzo DiMaio. Earth, wind, and fire, these three elemental entities comprised humankind's earliest understanding of the world and the forces that shape it. And over the millennia, while scientific knowledge has expanded our understanding, our instinctive fascination with that which is primal remains strong. Take, for example, our passion for finding endless ways to harness the wind, whether to move ourselves or simply a brightly colored object in the sky.
I love it for its flight because it flies so beautifully. It takes an angle of up into the sky that sometimes is right over your head. I also just love its character because it's very buoyant in the sky. It sometimes rises off your string like a balloon.
Known as the Rokaku maker by his peers and customers, Winslow Colwell is just one of a handful of kite makers in the country to craft the traditional Japanese kite. In his small studio workshop located above the falls of Otter Creek in Middlebury, Win has combined traditional craftsmanship with artistic designs inspired by the images of today.
I really wear two hats right now in my kite making. I make a traditional style kite, which is very much in keeping with the tradition of the Japanese kites, with very simple decoration, very classical. The one-of-a-kind kites that I'm making are inspired by dreams, probably newspapers, magazines, TV, books, everything. I think the onslaught of visual images that we get just kind of contributes to a huge visual inventory that we all carry around in our heads. And this is the sort of stuff that then spills out into my kites. The latest series of kites that I've made are all ones that feature the Greek god Phaeton on them. And his tumbling figure is the one that you see on a lot of my newer kites. I love coffee cups, and they keep throwing themselves into all of my kites. Feathers and tools are things that I also like to see on my kites. They're collaged, and you get an idea of lots of different worlds that collide onto one kite.
As proprietor of Windborne Kites since 1981, Wynn has made and sold a wide variety of kites. But within the last year, his emphasis has been on the Rokaku design. With some as high as 16 feet, the kite surface provides a perfect canvas for his artistry.
After I have worked out the design for the kite, knowing just how tall and wide the kite should be for it to fly well, I make a template out of heavy mat board or cardboard that then I can use to cut dozens of different kites from. The material that all of my kites are made out of is what's called ripstop nylon sailcloth. And it's the material which almost all kite makers use. It's incredibly strong, it's very lightweight, and it's just ideal for making kites. You can't have anything that has that kind of strength while still being so lightweight. After marking a line that guides me in sewing the hem around the edge of the kite, I take triangular pieces of a heavy background material and tack them into the corners as reinforcements. I use reinforcements on the kites in order to strengthen the places that take the most wear and tear on the kite. And this is one of those things that you just learn after trial and error. I've made a dozen kites without the reinforcements and saw that this was the very first place that they tended to wear. And so putting these triangular patches onto the corners of the kite, I quickly discovered added a lot of longevity to the kite. One of the things that makes my kites pretty unique among those that are made by any other kite makers is the way that I do my applique technique.
Another template is used to cut the applique shape from a colorful piece of material that will add contrast against the foundation cloth.
The hot knife is a wonderful tool. It cuts the material by heat and melts a very narrow swath through the material. It cuts very quickly, and the other advantage is that it actually singes the material as I cut through it. And so the material is slightly melted on the sides and won't fray very easily.
Once the applique shape is cut and inspected, it's placed in position on the foundation piece.
After I tack it onto the foundation cloth, I can very carefully stitch the applique onto the background using a zigzag stitch right along its edge. This is something that I have to do very carefully because I don't want to go off the edge nor too far into the applique. But once it's stitched, I can then reverse the material and trim the original cloth away from where the applique is. That allows the light to shine through the kite very brightly. It's kind of like stained glass. One of the most challenging things about learning how to make a real effective kite design is learning to imagine what that kite will look like in the air instead of the way it appears here on my desk or on my sewing machine table as I'm working on it. If I do not remove the background material from the kite, the colors will not have the same purity as if there's just one layer of material. If I make a design which is too small, and in the sky, it will just appear like a speck. So over years of kite making, all of my designs have gotten much bigger and much bolder. And so even when that kite is high in the sky, the design is still real clear to see and still reads to somebody on the ground. In working out the design of this kite years ago, selecting the right material for the bows was one of the most important decisions, because the original Rokkaku kites are made with a bamboo bow that goes across, and it's tapered, and so it's thinner on the edges and fatter in the center, and that changes how it flexes. And since I'm making a kite using Western materials rather than the bamboo, I wanted to somehow make a bow that would behave the same way. And what I decided on after experimenting for a while was a piece of fiberglass rod that has a stiffening member in the center. And so it will bend more on the outside than it will in the middle. And this gives the kite that same flying quality that the original Japanese ones have. The spine is made out of a hollow tube, which is much stiffer. And likewise, when you're working with bamboo, you'll make the spine for a Rokkaku kite using an entire piece of bamboo, which is also hollow in the center. Most people, when they see one of my kites at a craft fair or come up to my studio here, instantly ask if these kites need a tail. And it's a pretty logical question, because our Western kites often have long tails in order for them to fly well. The Japanese approached it differently. And in order to have a kite that flies with stability, they put an arch in the kite. And this arch is very important for having a kite that flies well. And too little or too much arch will really hurt the way it flies. You need to have just that right amount of dish that goes across the bow. I use strings that run across and that are adjustable by a little aluminum slider. And this slider you can adjust to more or less bow, and that's important for being able to fly in both light winds and in heavy winds.
The angle at which this particular kite flies is controlled by the adjustment of a bridle. For light winds, a steep angle is the best choice. Wind sets his bridles so that the kites will fly in just about any wind. Though the materials have changed, traditional kite designs have remained basically the same. The very first kite design dates back to 500 BC, when Lu Pan, a famous Chinese inventor and architect, crafted a wooden kite that resembled a dove in flight. The endless possibilities of flying an object in the air fascinated early enthusiasts. As early as the 5th century, there were reports of kites large enough to lift people in the air, making the kite the first means of human flight. Japan, Korea, Nepal, and India imported the art of kite making and quickly developed their own variations. By the 15th century, the kite had made its way to Europe, and from there it accompanied early settlers to the New World, where in 1752, Benjamin Franklin's famous thunderstorm flight vastly increased our understanding of electricity. In his exploration of flight, Alexander Graham Bell experimented extensively with complex box kites he dubbed tetrahedrals. In fact, the box kites developed by Australian Lawrence Hargrave in the 1880s are considered the most important contribution to the success of the Wright brothers 15 years later. In an age of powered flight, the scientific value of kites faded rapidly. But in the 1950s, a NASA researcher invented a remarkable design called the Flexikite, later to be known as the Delta or Bat Kite. Today, with only slight modifications in materials and design, deltas, boxes, and even diamonds are flown by children and adults around the world with the same enthusiasm experienced by their inventors.
Kite flying is something that people of any country and people of any age all find equally enjoyable. That it's sharing a little bit of magic up there in the sky, or just a little bit of thoroughly unambitious joy, and it bonds people together.
While kite flying events are commonplace in other parts of the world, it's not often that you'll find a group of Vermonters gathering to fly kites, formally or otherwise.
Back in 1985, a woman named Jane Parker Ambrose came up with a nifty idea, which is to try to organize people all over the world to be flying kites on one particular day. And for the 6 years since then, we've tried to be participating in that here in Middlebury by having a One Sky, One World kite fly. Her idea is to have people all over the world flying kites. It's just a symbol of the fact that kite flying is something that's done all over the world, and it's one way that we can show our ability to be cooperative, even in a global scale, and to do something in solidarity with each other that is as fun and is such a celebration as kite flying is.
You feel it? You see how it moves, turns it?
Yeah.
For me and my family, it's a great time to be together, share things together, and just go out for a good time. It doesn't cost anything. The air is free. And flies have traditionally always been a lot of fun. We've been to about 4 of them. And it's a good time, good camaraderie with everyone, see what they've made and what they're flying, what's new on the circuit, and just have a great time.
Okay, go ahead, Dave. I love the spirit of it, which is that we don't necessarily have to be too organized. And Jane really encourages people to fly kites wherever they happen to be that day, even if they're flying all by themselves.
What I like about kite flying is the same sort of like fishing. You have an activity to do and enjoy the weather, look at the view, and occasionally it gets exciting when the wind picks up. Or one time I was flying and there were some kids behind me. We got hit with a whirlwind that knocked the kids off their feet and took the kites way up in the sky. So there's always unexpected things that happen, and that's fun.
I've been flying kites for a long time with my dad. Whenever he goes out to fly kites, I like to go with him. He's been to many kite festivals. And I've won a trophy at one for the best homemade kite. It was for this one. This is a bowed kite that will bow backwards when there's too much wind. It makes it so it doesn't catch so much wind, and then it flies better. But today it needs lots of wind.
Forget the sun and the wind, both. We're in good shape. Okay, you want to walk it out a bit, Dave? And I'll launch it then. I'm going to hand the string right over to you. Yep. You just have to watch out that he doesn't get the string tangled in his hand. OK, keeps wanting to fly himself. It's like pulling yourself up by your own bootstraps. Okay. Great. One of the things about organizing a kite festival is that weather is the thing that's totally out of your control, and so you just have to take whatever you get. And today, the wind is blowing from 0 to maybe 1.5 miles an hour. But in the spirit of kiting, we just take whatever we get. And today, this is what we get. So we're going to run around and try to make our own wind. That's all you can do.
In the absence of the high winds needed to work the stunters at their full potential, it takes a lot of backpedaling to generate enough lift for a colorful demonstration of these two-line kites.
We're up. The thing that makes stunt kites different than your traditional kites is that they're flying on two strings. And with two strings, you can control the kite and really make it go anywhere in the sky that you like. They can go to the top of the sky, and then you can bring them down just to within a foot of the ground. You can control the kite into loops and circles. And with this as a start, if there's a poet in you, you can really make the kite dance. Discovery of the stunt kite maybe 15 years ago just sparked a whole new wave of people who started to fly kites. People who would never have thought that they would enjoy flying kites before try one of these stunt kites and find that they've just got to keep doing it. It's a lot of fun, and the two-line stunt kites are a lot more active. You're not going to fall asleep while flying a stunt kite, and instead you're probably going to be leaning back and putting all your weight into just keeping your feet on the ground rather than getting dragged across the beach. Stunt kites are fast. Some of them go over 100 miles an hour. They're real noisy sometimes. They're a lot of fun. They really get your heart pumping. I get a lot of simple pleasure out of kite flying still. The world is a busy place, and the concerns of trying to make a livelihood and trying to keep one's body and soul together these days is a challenge. And I find that kite flying just is still one of the most restful and centering things that I can do. The production kites that I'm making are sold mostly to people who are out there flying kites frequently. The one-of-a-kind kites that I make, I think, are more frequently going to be found flying in the imaginations of those who buy them. They'll be put on a wall or hung into a cathedral ceiling well, where they will fly mostly in their dreams. Which is fine with me. I think there's something wonderful about how seeing a kite sparks one's memories of kites and really evokes the whole sensation of flight. And you don't even really have to fly it in order to have that little special spark lit inside you.
As we slip ever closer to the deep freeze of yet another winter, it's time once again to bid farewell to the warm months with our annual tribute to the timeless miracle known as autumn. And that's Crossroads for this time. We hope you enjoyed the program and that you'll be with us next week when we'll introduce you to the world of the military vehicle collector and recreate the terrible thrill of modern warfare. Till then, for all of us at Crossroads, I'm Enzo Di Maio. See you next week.
Coming up next on Vermont ETV, marking the 27th anniversary of the assassination of President Kennedy, NOVA presents an encore broadcast of Who Shot President Kennedy? The program probes the available evidence surrounding Kennedy's 1963 assassination using previously unavailable technology. That's next on NOVA.
Broadcast funding for Crossroads is provided in part by the Lintelac Foundation, supporting innovative programs in Vermont.